sooner or later you're going to come across. Yeah. Well, it's that time of year again, that spooky time of year, Halloween, and all the little jack-o'-lanterns and ghoulish figures are being put outside the homes of where the young children live. But it brings me round to thinking about the temporary nature of life, and that veil between the living and the dead, they say, is a very, very thin veil this time of the year. And I've been recently reading a book about the early barrow diggers. The barrows were places which were used as burial mounds, if you like, and they were used right up until the early Anglo-Saxon times to bury the dead. I found out something interesting. Pagans and heathens, they got their names from the locations where they lived. Pagan came from Pagani, which means a settlement or a small rural enclave. And heathens got that name because they were people that lived on the heathland. And Christianity came over to the British Isles around about sort of with the Romans, 0 BC, I suppose, or yeah, 0 AD rather. It was spread throughout these islands, and the people of the heathlands and the people of the Pagani regions, they were the last to be indoctrinated into the Christian faith. But then it went on to become heathen and pagan became slang and derogatory terms according to the Christian context. But anyway, with this video I'm interested in what our ancestors I'm talking of 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 years ago, what they did with their dead. And I'm going to visit two burial mounds, two Longbarrows, one of which you've seen on the channel before, and one which you haven't seen and which hardly anybody knows about, and it's right on the outskirts of Swindon. Hardly anybody knows about it. So I've got my drone, camera equipment on my back. I got a new bike. It's a 29er. I'll show you that as well, and I'll tell you the reasons why I got that. But I haven't got it tricked out for bike packing yet, but this is gonna be my new bike packing bike. You'll get to see that shortly. Anyway, I got a few miles to pedal. Anyway, we're up on the ridgeway now, not far to go to the first burial chamber, which is Wayland Smithy. And actually from this point on, we are totally off-road all the way for another 10 or 15 mile. And when I mean off-road, I mean properly off-road. Bridle ways, single track, places you couldn't even take a motorcycle. I love this type of cycling. I had to stop back there, calling nature. Anyway, yeah. Basically, with this bike, if you can walk there, you can cycle this bike there. It is that good. with those bigger 29-inch wheels, they just roll over anything. Almost. Oh, this is Wayland Smithy. Been here loads of times. We'll visit it once more. Hiya. Basically, it's a chambered tomb. I think they found the remains of 14 people in here. They were excarnated. In other words, the skeletons were, well, the bodies were allowed to rot out in the open, and then they were placed in here. Long bones, skulls, and all sorts of other disarticulated bones. But the other Longbarrow I'm going to go and see, I believe they were inhumated. In other words, they were buried intact. When they died, they just buried them in that barrow. So we're going to go and see that in a minute. But this is Wayland Smithy, a chambered Longbarrow, one of the finest in England, so I'm told. There's the view out from the stones. Or the metal part of the gravel part of the byway petered out about 100 yards back there. We're now on just a rough track. The bike rolls over it beautifully. I'm making my way to Knighton Bush's plantation, which they think was an ancient settlement. So it'd be nice to go and see that. Not in bushes, it sounds very enigmatic. Possibly an old way this, because you can see it's how the bank rises up a bit there. There's a ditch to my right, so that would indicate possibly quite an old track. I really am quite off the beaten track now. Well, having said that, there is a beaten track actually, but quite an open expanse. This is what we call the downland in this part of Wiltshire. All the highland, especially if it's made of chalk, is known as downs for some reason. I'm not sure why. It's fairly up, if you get the drift. The interesting feature in the landscape over there, I think. Lovely folds in the landscape. The woodland in the dip over there, that's Pingoose Covert or Pingoose Covert. Up on the brow, Liddington Hill Fort. And then my way forward down to Knighton Bushes. Thank you. Well, I've arrived rather windswept out on that Knighton Bushes plantation. It looks very inviting in there. It's gamekeepered. There's a game rearing going on. I can see the bird feeders. So, private property, no doubt. But, I'd like to take a look in there. Well, get the helmet stuck. I'm on my own in here anyway. The reasons why I know I'm on my own is that wood pigeons have just taken off. So that's a clear indication there's nobody else in the woods, so I'm safe to sort of have a little meander through. Now you can see a couple of the bird feeders. Predominantly beech by the looks of it. Rather beautiful woodland. So it's thought that Knighton Bushes was a settlement way back in the past. Certainly a beautiful place, and it's right out in the middle of nowhere. Look at the squirrel. Caught in by the wares. And there's a mound here, a mound been thrown up. What that's all about, I don't know. You can see where the deer have been lying. There's a fresh scrape here, really fresh. That's where roe deer has been lying. It just got up and scarpered, and you can see it made its way over that way. Fantastic. I'll tell you what, I'll have to come back and camp here, I think. Such a lovely bit of woodland, this. Really nice. Ideal for a stealth camp. I think that could be on the cards pretty soon. Watch this space, shall we say. Look how well camouflaged the bike is, the boot zipper, in olive green. Ideal stealth camping machine. I'll show you the bike in more detail in a minute, but it's time to move on now from Knighton Bushes plantation and out into the wind. Super windy up there, but just stopping here. Apple tree. I'm not sure if they're eaters. I might have a go. Have a go at one of those. Free for the picking. I've had to seek shelter in the lee of this bush here. Squally wind has come through, carrying a lot of rain, and I just have to rest here for a bit, I think, and wait for this to pass. Super exposed section now. Another big squall of bamboo that came in, just blew through. And clear again now, so we've got to cycle along here. And then that the hill, it's quite steep that hill, so that'd be a bit of a hike. I have to this route just moments ago. It was lashing down with rain, and now it's all blew through. No doubt to be followed by more squally wet weather. Definitely a change in the weather now as we move into the latter part of autumn. So maybe things are going to get a bit colder going forward. But look at the wonderful view I've got over that way there. That's more or less the direction I've come from. I come right across country through this area here. And down there in the hollow, that's Botley Copse, a lovely remote ancient woodland. Well, I had to hike the bike up a lot of that hill back there because it was just so steep and so rutted, and motorcycles and 4x4s have rutted it up, and difficult to pedal on. But I'm back on a nice farm track now. So what sort of a farmer leaves all of his implements out in the weather like that? God, blimey, he must have a lot of money if he can afford to leave them out to rust and rot like that. Anyway, look at this lovely track going down and the beech trees. Noise of traffic pervades the senses now as I climb over this bridge. A little bit of road section, as you can see, it's a very quiet road section as I make my way to the village of Baden, which is the highest village hereabouts. But we're going over the awful M4 motorway. Horrible. Where is the spirit of man? Whenever a storm blows through, I just come off the side of the road, get into the lee of the trees and the bushes, and it keeps probably about 80% of the wind and the rain off of you. So I haven't come out of any waterproofs. Well, I have. It's my skin. Skin's waterproof, so I'm told. Just wait for this to blow over. But I'm just examining the black spots on what looks to be like a sycamore. I've just come out of the village of Baden, the highest village in the district, and I'll shortly be afforded the most beautiful view. It's difficult to see and stop when you're on a motorcycle or a car. Well, actually it's not only impossible because it's a clearway road and it's a very fast road. But the bicycle affords me the opportunity to pull in and get off of it and take a lovely photograph and show you this most wonderful of views coming up. I've had a short section to ride on the road there, about a mile, and back onto the byway again. This is a beautiful byway, this, and it takes us up the side of a wood, overlooks a lovely valley, and then on to where the Lidington Longbarrow is. Really nice piece of byway. I rode it on the motorbike a year or two back, and I got stuck halfway along. Had to lay the bike over and turn it round and pick it up and bring it back again. It was difficult. On this bike, it rolls so well. It's a doddle, absolute doddle. Look at the colours as the sunlight shines through those leaves. Beautiful, just beautiful. It's not about a destination, it's about the journey. It is sound for my soul, I tell you. It does me the world of good. Look, isn't that a lovely byway? Well, almost at the top of the byway now. Bit of a bump here. Get up over that. Yeah, bit of a climb. Low gear ratios make it fairly easy. Obviously, it's not an e-bike. You've got to put a bit of effort in, but it's all good for your health. Anyway, that's what I'm riding along at. It's rolling along it beautifully. The ruts, just climbs over the ruts. We're almost at the top now. Easy. And when you fall off, it doesn't hurt because there's no weight and you're not going very fast. It went over because going up on that 6 to 8 inch rut there when it slipped on the grass. I suppose I really should say a bit of a disclaimer, really, because when you come off road and you're cycling along ruts and tracks like that, whether it's on a motorcycle or push bike, you're potentially in a hazardous situation and you can fall off, as I just did. But luckily, it only took me to pick the bike up. Had that been a motorbike, there'd have been help required probably, and possibly damage incurred to the bike. But you can fall off these bikes, these lightweight bicycles, all the time, and have hardly any scrapes. Fingers crossed we don't have any more scrapes. But it is going to happen. This is one of those things. Sooner or later you're going to come across. Yeah. So this is the boot zipper, all steel framed bicycle with a 1x12 drive train. Brilliant for hill climbing. I'm not sure, I can't remember what the ratios are. I think it's 34 on the front and possibly 50 or 55 on the back for the small winding gear. I'm not absolutely sure on that, but if anyone who's interested, you can look it up. It's got SRAM hydraulic disc brakes. I would have liked mechanical brakes, but that wasn't an option available at the time, so I've had to go with the hydraulic brakes. On the forks, it's got three little holes, mounting holes for special bike packing bags that you can mount on the forks, on the back chain stay, on the seat stay rather. There's also two more holes for mounting and racks and various other items. It's got a gusseted frame, so it's reinforced at the headstock area. Lovely bike. I've put on ergonomic grips to make it more comfortable, and I bought it from online, paid with my own money, so non-affiliated. This is my own money. Most important thing, I almost forgot to mention it, is the fact that it's got 29 inch wheels, and this really helps. Well, it feels, from my perspective as riding it, because I've come from a 26 inch bike, I've still got the 26 inch mountain bike, I'll be riding that from time to time, but the 29 inch wheels seem to roll over things so easily, and it also carries a fair bit of speed as well, so that's a good thing. And one other good thing as well about this bike, which gives me a lot of confidence, is the fact that the axles are through axles. I noticed on my old mountain bike, if I pedaled really, really hard, I could twist the drive, the back wheel, a little bit and almost make it rev on the frame. With this one, that's impossible to happen. And it's also reassuring when you're hurtling down a steep hill that your wheels aren't going to fall off. It's a really well-built bike. Now just a couple of hundred yards away from the Longbarrow, and it's on the promontory, the high spot. If you didn't know what it was, you just sail on past without second thought. But it's a 5,000 plus year old Neolithic chambered Longbarrow. We're almost there. This old fence post, I can tell you, is approximately 150 years old, and I'll tell you the reasons how I know that. Barrow mound, I don't know, but they did. When they put the fence through, they unearthed three intact skeletons, and subsequently a fourth was found a few years later, I think. I'd love to be able to fly the drone for you, but it's just too windy. So this is the far northern. I've come over to the other side of the barrow now. It's quite an impressive structure. It's probably about 6 to 7 foot tall at this point. It's longer than Wayland Smithy, and there's probably more burials still in it. because it hasn't been fully excavated. Quite what you could hear of me in all that wind, I don't know, but anyway, that's the Lidington Longbarrow, where four skeletons were unearthed when they put the fence through in 1880. It's a bit sad really, I suppose, when you think of these old burials being unearthed and disturbed, and it all happened when people started to forget about those early people, who they were, and they fell out of living memory, if you like. And then along came, well, I suppose there was a time when people were just ploughing into these things, treasure hunting, destroying them. And then we had the great age of the antiquarians, around about the 16th to the 17th century, and the likes of Stukeley and Hoare, and a few others who took an interest. And then, although some of their methods lacked a lot of finesse, they had no scientific method. They just were basically just rifling through and finding these ancient burials and grave goods, etc., you know. But from that, things improved, and we got that was the birth of archaeology, and it just as the years rolled on, by the end of the 19th century, turn of the 20th century, you had people like Pitt Rivers who was examining these burial chambers, and by then they'd refined the scientific method, and they were taking notes of the strata, the positions of the burials, the grave goods, etc., in minute detail. But if it hadn't been for the great antiquarians, although they did decimate a lot of things, I mean, it may not have evolved to archaeology that we have today. But I'm no archaeologist, of course. I'm just a layman. I'm just a Wiltshireman. That's all I am. But those people that lived all those years back, they've now been forgotten. They've passed out of living memory. They've been forgotten. And it makes me think, this time of year, Halloween, you know, you think of the people that were around and they're no longer here. And sure, as sure can be, they've been forgotten. And yet it says, lest we forget. You know, at the going down of the sun, lest we forget. But ultimately, I think everybody gets forgot. We all get forgotten. And in a strange way, a strange kind of way, I'm sort of happy with that.
So why am I happy with that, you might think? Well, simple really, isn't it? Because it's nature's way. It's nature's way.
See you in the next video.